New York City, when the Me Generation adopted the hustle of the streets and a new sound was erupting from the underground. 1973, shaping the culture.
I met a guy at Billboard named Bill Wardlow who was doing their charts. I would call him up and say, I need a bullet this week, I need to be number 22, I need to be number 6, or in one or two cases, I need to be number 1. And he would do it. And we would make sure he hung out with Donna Summer and made him a happy puppy. Payola was all over the place. Cash, there was cocaine, there was hookers, some kind of sort of payment for service that isn't necessarily legal to do. I was dealing with the FM progressive radio stations. I would do blow with these people. We'd go for dinner a lot. And that's how a lot of records got played. It worked. Everybody played ball.
There was tastemakers, and you'd pay them, and then other people would catch on.
Well, the first person would be the program director. Second person would be the music director.
DJs were probably grossly underpaid. They really were doing the community a service because they were gatekeepers, they had big personalities, they worked very hard at their jobs, and they had our ears.
In a lot of ways, I view it as it was leveling the playing field. R&B radio stations were owned by white people who paid the black staff very poorly. It helped black DJs, you know, eat.
Frankie Crocker, the chief rocker, became the single most influential DJ in all of America.
Frankie would charge $3,000 to anybody, it didn't matter who you were, to play a record. And he would play it for like 3 weeks. And if the record became a hit, he would keep playing it. If it didn't, he would stop playing it. It was research and development. If it was a totally unknown artist that the radio station might have be questioned about, it might have been more money to take the gamble. It just depended on which station it was and how bad you wanted the record. It went further than just the disc jockey. It went to the record retail level. We would give record stores that we knew were reporting to the big trade magazines like Billboard and Cashbox, we would give them free records to sell if they would report our product, that whichever song we were working at the time, as selling much better than it was. Because that would move it up on the charts, which would get us more radio airplay.
If a person works for a record company, he just has to go back to his boss and say, I got this record added. I don't think he's got anything emotionally involved in it.
The bean counters weren't kept in the loop.
We would look at different accounting statements, and I'd always go, what is that?
You'd get some receipts from local restaurants and stuff that you'd go to anyway, and they liked you, and you gave them business, so they'd give you some blank receipts. And it would go on the expense report, and then I'd have cash. In Boston, there was this restaurant, and you'd go with a bunch of DJs and program directors and stuff. And if you ordered a specific dish, it would come with under the top plate, there'd be a bag of cocaine. It was nuts, but we did it. And it also made it fun, and that was part of partying every day. Hey, you have an idea that's crazy? Let's try it. You know, maybe it'll work.
The drug culture of the 60s, there was something communitarian about it. By 73, it was about, you know, let's get stoned, let's get ripped, let's get twisted.